Allan Poe is one of the most legendary writers of all time. His only novel that he wrote was about four shipwrecked men who ran out of food and resort to cannibalism, eating the cabin boy named Richard Parker. 46 years after it was published, a yacht sank in real life, and three of the four survivors also decided to eat the cabin boy, who was also named Richard Parker. Morgan Robertson was an author who wrote a lot of short stories and is most famous for his novella, The Wreck of the Titan, or Futility. And it was about, well, it was pretty much about the Titanic. The difference being that the Titanic didn't happen until 14 years after the book was written. And the similarities between the Titan and the Titanic were incredible. Like, to the T, it was the same story. Spooky, right? But he wasn't the only one who wrote about the Titanic years before it happened. There was another man, and he actually died on the Titanic. His name was William T. Stead, and he was a spunky journalist who actually wrote not one but two stories that mirrored the Titanic years before the actual wreck happened. So there's much more to the story to tell, but suffice to say that these three writers all wrote a story that later became something that was an event that happened in real life. So I think it can be marked as evidence for their tapping into the cosmic consciousness. Now let's talk about Philip K. Dick. Philip K. Dick is one of the greatest science fiction writers of all time, but more than that, he has consistently and often written things that came true in his own life. There are many examples of it, but he was able to tap into a consciousness outside of his own self. One of the best examples is when his infant son had a birth defect that they weren't picking up at any doctor they would take him to. They didn't see it. They just didn't do the right tests. And so what it was a right inguinal hernia that had popped the hydrocele and moved into his scrotum sac, and it was going to kill him if he didn't get emergency surgery. That was his infant son. So he saved his infant son's life through some consciousness that he connected with. And I think that's one of the most remarkable things that he did. It's one of the most convincing, because how would you know all that? I mean, down to the hydrocele being broken, that's incredible.
Phil had a vision while napping, and he came out to the living room and told me exactly what was wrong with Christopher. And I called up the doctor and made another appointment, and Phil was right.
The doctor did indeed find a very severe inguinal hernia that could have been fatal had it not been treated, and the baby had immediate surgery.
This exact diagnosis of Christopher's illness causes some witnesses to believe that Philip K. Dick acquired information from outside his normal consciousness.
Phil only took LSD twice, and both times I gave it to him. And the first time he had quite a good experience. The second time he had a very bad experience. He was a gladiator in ancient Rome. And what happened to Phil was that even though he had never studied Latin, and I studied Latin in high school, so I could understand Latin, but he began speaking Latin when he was that gladiator. He was speaking good Latin, grammatically correct, but easygoing, as if he'd spoken it as a native tongue. And that was spooky.
A lot of the stories that Philip K. Dick wrote have been made into movies and television because we identify with them on some very deep level. His work, The Man in the High Castle, is an alternate timeline story about what if the Nazi regime won the war in World War II, how different the world would be. Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep was probably his most famous work because it was the inspiration for the film Blade Runner, which is known as pretty much the greatest science fiction film of all time, but it explores how robots integrating with people would work. And then there's Minority Report, which is about precognitive crime. And they've actually recently published some findings. Basically, we have Minority Report technology. We have precognitive or technology before a crime has been committed. We can go catch the person who would have committed the crime. I'm going to let Philip K. Dick tell you the way that he told everyone in 1977 about how he found inspiration for his story.
I, in my stories and novels, often write about counterfeit worlds, semi-real worlds, as well as deranged private worlds, inhabited often by just one person, while meantime the other characters either remain in their own worlds throughout or are somehow drawn into one of the peculiar ones. This theme occurs in the corpus of my 27 years of writing. At no time did I have a theoretical or conscious explanation for my preoccupation with these pluriform pseudo-worlds, but now I think I understand. What I was sensing was the manifold of partially actualized realities lying tangent to what evidently is the most actualized one, the one which the majority of us, by consensus gentium, agree on.
So what is consensus gentium that he was talking about? What does that mean? Well, it's the idea that if everyone believes something, then it must be true. It comes from Latin, agreement of the people, and it's the idea that the general agreement among people is a sufficient condition of truth. But the weakness of this criterion, that if everybody believes it, it must be true, the weakness of this is obvious because throughout human history, the consensus beliefs of humanity, for example, geocentrism, and now reverse geocentrism because apparently it's like something else is happening with Earth, but they've turned out to be false. So we can all believe something for a long time, but a belief is not true because it is believed. It should be believed because it is true.
I had a short, acute flash of recovered memory. The total body of memories, intact and entire, began to return. You are free to believe me or to disbelieve, but please take my word on it that I am not joking. This is very serious, a matter of importance. It's a common theme in my writing that a dark-haired girl shows up at the door of the protagonist and tells him that his world is delusional, that there's something false about it. Well, this did finally happen to me. I even knew their hair would be black. I had an actual complete sense of what she would look like and what she would say.
The dark-haired girl is a theme in a lot of Philip K. Dick books, like Rachel in Blade Runner, or Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? And he even has a collection of work called The Dark-Haired Girl. Of all of the motifs of his work that he has written that had come to be in real life, she is probably the most significant to him.
She did appear. She was a total stranger. And she did inform me of this fact, that some of my fictional works were, in a literal sense, true. I wrote out these dreams in novel after novel, story after story, to name two in which this prior ugly present obtained most clearly. I cite The Man in the High Castle and my 1974 novel about the U.S. as a police state called So My Fears, the Policeman Said. I'm going to be very candid with you. I wrote both novels based on fragmentary residual memories of such a horrid slave state world. People claim to remember past lives. I claim to remember a different, very different present life. I know of no one who has ever made this claim before, but I rather suspect that my experience is not unique. What perhaps is unique is the fact that I'm willing to talk about it. The only clue we have to it is when some variable is changed and some alteration in our reality occurs. We would have the overwhelming impression that we were reliving the present, deja vu. Perhaps in precisely the same way, hearing the same words, saying the same words, I submit that these impressions are valid and significant. And I will even say this, such an impression is a clue that at some past time point, a variable was changed. Because of this, an alternative world branched off.
There's a man named Anthony Peake who does studies on consciousness, and he just did he wrote a book about Philip K. Dick, and it's called The Man Who Remembered the Future. And he actually didn't know at the time that he wrote the book, but, well, he was told by a man who came to see a lecture of his that he thought Philip K. Dick had precognitively predicted him. So here he is telling that story.
And then he said, well, of course, you're probably totally aware that Philip K. Dick probably predicted you. And I said, I don't know what you mean. And he said, have you read the book Counterclock World? And I said, no, I haven't. And he said, in Counterclock World, there is a character who is to do with life after death, resurrection after death, the idea of what happens to consciousness after death, and everything else. And he turned around to me and he said, now, Philip K. Dick loved making up odd names for people. He could have chosen any name, any configuration. He called this person Anarch Peak. Now, he said he's got the first two letters of your first name. He's got the first four letters of your second name. And he said, just imagine if Phil had seen your name in some kind of hypnagogic dream sequence, which Phil did have, and he just saw your name somehow, and then tried to make it up and said Anarch Peak.
This is especially interesting because Anthony Peake's book about Philip K. Dick was called The Man Who Remembered the Future. And the book with the name similar to Anthony Peake's name in it was based on a short story called Your Appointment Will Be Yesterday. Now, in literary terms, that's called reverse chronology. That's what writers use when things are out of order. But in the real life, that's called retrocausality or retrocausation. And in my video about out-of-place technology, which I plan to do more videos about that, it's plain to see that there are a lot of examples of wireless technology that have happened before the 1900s. And during the early 1900s, there were a lot of examples of wireless phones being used. So, yeah, flip over to my other video if you want to see that, but this is what I think is an example of retrocausality. I'm going to read an excerpt from something Philip K. Dick wrote in 1978. It was a year after that speech, and it's from a little paper called How to Build a Universe That Doesn't Fall Apart 2 days later. All right, so I'm just going to skip around and it bears me. I can't claim to be an authority on anything, but I can honestly say that certain matters absolutely fascinate me, and I write about them all the time. The two basic topics which fascinate me are what is reality and what constitutes the authentic human being. One day, a girl college student in Canada asked me to define reality for her for a paper she was writing for a philosophy class. She wanted a one-sentence answer. I thought about it and finally said, reality is that which, when you stop believing in it, it doesn't go away. Because today we live in a society in which spurious realities are manufactured by the media, by governments, big corporations, religious groups, political groups, etc., I asked in my writing, what is real? Because unceasingly, we are bombarded with pseudo-realities manufactured by sophisticated people using pretty sophisticated electronic mechanisms. I do not distrust their motives, I distrust their power, and they have a lot of it. And yet the strange thing is, in some way, some real way, much of what appears under the title science fiction is true. It may not be literally true, I suppose. The producers of that film never intended for us to believe it, or did they? We haven't been invaded by creatures from another star system as depicted in Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Or have we? And more important, if they did intend to state this, the writers of that film, is it actually true? That is the issue, not does the author or producer believe it is true, but is it actually true? Because quite by accident, in the pursuit of a good yarn, a science fiction author or producer or scriptwriter might stumble onto the truth and only later realize it, or not even realize it. The basic tool for the manipulation of reality is the manipulation of words. George Orwell made this clear in his novel 1984. Comprehension follows perception. That's why the power of TV to influence young minds is so staggeringly vast. Words and pictures are synchronized. An EEG of a person watching TV shows that after about half an hour, the brain decides nothing is happening, and it goes into a hypnoidal twilight state emitting alpha waves. And I say this as a professional fiction writer. The producers, scriptwriters, and directors who create these video, audio worlds do not know how much of their content is true. Speaking for myself, I do not know how much of my writing is true, or which parts, if any, are true. In fact, that's part of the problem. You cannot legislate an author into correctly labeling his product. You cannot compel him to declare what part is true and what part isn't if he himself does not know. And it is an eerie experience to write something into a novel, believing it is pure fiction, and to learn later on, perhaps years later, that it is true. If I could give you an example, it's something I do not understand myself. Perhaps you can come up with a theory. I cannot. In 1970, I wrote a novel called Flow My Tears, the policeman said. One of the characters is a 19-year-old girl named Kathy. Her husband's name is Jack. Kathy appears to work for the criminal underground, but later, as we read deeper into the novel, we discover that actually, she's working for the police. She has a relationship going on with the police inspector. The character is pure fiction, or at least, I thought it was. Anyhow, on Christmas Day of 1970, I meet a girl named Kathy. This is after I'd finished the novel. She was 19 years old, her boyfriend was named Jack. I soon learned that Kathy was a drug dealer. I spent months trying to get her to give up dealing drugs. I kept warning her again and again she's going to get caught. Then one evening, as we were entering a restaurant together, Kathy stopped short and said, I can't go in. Seated in the restaurant was a police inspector whom I knew. I have to tell you the truth, Kathy said. I have a relationship with him. Now certainly these are odd coincidences. Perhaps I have precognition. But the mystery becomes even more perplexing. The next stage totally baffles me. It's been 4 years now. So in 1974, the novel was published, and one afternoon I was talking to my priest, and I happened to mention to him an important scene near the end of the novel in which the character Felix Buckman meets a black stranger at an all-night gas station, and they begin to talk. As I described the scene in more and more detail, my priest became progressively more agitated. At last he said, that is a scene from the book of Acts in the Bible. In Acts, the person who meets the black man on the road, the name is Philip, your name. Father Ross was so upset by the resemblance that he could not even locate the scene in the Bible. Read Acts, he instructed me, and you'll agree, it's the same down to specific details. I went home and I read the scene in Acts. Yes, Father Ross was right. The scene in my novel was an obvious retelling of the scene in Acts. And I'd never read Acts, I must admit. But again, the puzzle became deeper. In Acts, the high Roman official who arrests and interrogates St. Paul is named Felix, the same as my character. And my character, Felix Buckman, is a high-ranking police general. In fact, in my novel, he holds the same office as Felix in the book of Acts, the final authority. There's a conversation in my novel which very, very closely resembles a conversation between Felix and Paul. Well, I decided to try for any further resemblances. So the main character in my novel is named Jason. So I got an index to the Bible and looked to see if anyone named Jason appears. A man named Jason appears once and only once in the Bible. It's in the book of Acts, and as if to plague me further with coincidences, in my novel, Jason is fleeing from the authorities and takes refuge in a person's house. And in Acts, the man Jason shelters a fugitive from the law in his house, an exact inversion of the situation in my novel. And this mysterious spirit responsible for all this was having sort of a laugh about the whole thing. So in Acts, the disciple Philip baptizes the black man who then goes away rejoicing. In my novel, Felix Buckman reaches out to the black stranger for emotional support because Felix's sister has just died and he's feeling sad. It's an encounter between two strangers on the road which changes the life of one of them, both in my novel and in Acts. And one final quirk by the mysterious spirit at work. The name Felix is Latin for the word happy, which I did not know when I wrote the novel. A careful study of my novel shows that for reasons which I cannot even begin to explain, I had managed to retell several of the basic incidents from the particular book of the Bible. And I even had the right names. What could explain this? That was 4 years ago that I discovered all this, and for 4 years I've tried to come up with a theory, and I have not. I doubt if I ever will. But the mystery had not ended there. 2 months ago I was walking up to my mailbox late at night to mail a letter and also enjoy the sight of St. Joseph's Church, which sits opposite my apartment building. I noticed a man, and on impulse I walked up to him and asked, is anything the matter? I'm out of gas, the man said, and I have no money. Incredibly, because I have never done this before, I got out my wallet, took out all the money from it, and handed the money to him. He then shook hands with me and asked where I lived so he could pay me back later. Then I realized the money would do him no good since there's not a gas station within walking distance, so I went and got my car, and the man had a metal gas can in the trunk of his car, so together we drove in my car to an all-night gas station. Soon we were standing there, two strangers, at the pump, filling the metal gas can, and suddenly I realized that all this was the scene in my novel, the novel written 8 years before. The all-night gas station was exactly as I had envisioned it in my inner eye when I wrote the scene. The glaring white light, the pump jockey, and now I saw something which I had not seen before. The stranger who I was helping was black. I had literally lived out a scene completely as it happened in my novel. I was terribly shaken up by this experience. This is to say I had lived out sort of a replica of the scene of Acts where Philip encountered the black man on the road. What could explain all this? The answer I've come up with in my head may not be correct, but it's the only answer I have. It has to do with time. My theory is this. In some certain important sense, time is not real. Or perhaps it is real, but not as we experience it to be or imagine it to be. I have the acute, overwhelming certitude, and I still have, that despite all the change we see, a specific, permanent landscape underlies this world of change, and that this invisible, underlying landscape is that of the Bible. It, specifically, is the period immediately following the death and resurrection of Christ. It is, in other words, the time period of the book of Acts. One thing I want everyone to think about, though, is if Philip K. Dick's writings would come true, what about Orwell's 1984? Could that have been an alternate historical timeline of 1984? What about Arthur C. Clarke's 2001 Space Odyssey? Could that have been? And Arthur C. Clarke, in fact, didn't he invent the first satellite? So I think that we should take another look at our favorite movies and our favorite books. and maybe ask ourselves why they're our favorites. What resonates within us about what's going on in the world, in our lives, is real. So they're making a new Blade Runner. You guys hear about this? It's called Blade Runner 2049. And it has Harrison Ford in it. Well, anyway, just wanted to mention that. So in conclusion, I want to stress that the theory of the computer simulation was, in fact, Philip K. Dick's way of trying to explain it away. And that's natural, to explain things to our own minds. It's natural to interpret and make sense of things when we cannot, when in fact it's nonsensical, when it's absurd. And I think that's what we're going through, all of us, with the effects. And we see our world changing in ways that it can't. So when we witness this, we try to make sense of it. Now, I'm not saying that it's not a computer simulation, but I would like to suggest that perhaps, in fact, the computer simulation programmer, if you will, is a divine force. And the computer simulation is, in fact, the world as we know it, as the divine force created. And there's really no need to put a label or a category on such a divine force. There's no name that we need to give this divine force, but with our consciousness, we are all able to tap into it, because there are teachings that actually the physicists have all gone to, their ancient teachings that basically describe there being a consciousness of the unity and a consciousness of the self, and that those two are both together. They're entangled.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.